Welcome to another episode of Pound for Pound Boxing Report. I'm your host, Michael. Joining me this week, first time on Pound for Pound Boxing Report, Boxing TV. What's going on, brother?
Thank you so much for having me. Really glad to be on the show.
Indeed. Also, my usual regulars, Gail of Communities Digital News, Jacob from Japa Boxing, Gus from Corruption in Boxing, Daniel from The Inscriber. What's going on, ladies and gents?
Good evening. I think we're all more irregulars tonight. It's just going to be that kind of a show. Well, I'm warning y'all right now.
Yeah, we just had pretty late.
We started offline tonight.
I apologize for starting the show late. We had a bit of a back and forth there within the past couple of minutes. That was quite entertaining.
Don't bring up Kell Brook's name.
For those who are new to the Pound for Pound Box Report, Pound for Pound Boxing Report is a live YouTube show as well as podcast and blog that discusses all things boxing. The motto is, when boxing is good, we will talk about it. When boxing is bad, we will talk about it. Bottom line is, if it concerns boxing, we will talk about it. To find more information about Pound for Pound Box Report, just go to the blog page, p4pboxreport.wordpress.com. Look to the right of the blog page. You'll find links to find us all over social media, all over the interwebs. Links to find us on Facebook, G+, the Twitter handle. Links to find the Tumblr page, the YouTube page, the Pinterest board. Links to find the RSS feed if you want to check us out there. Also, links to find us on Stitcher Radio, Flipboard Magazine, SoundCloud, iTunes, as well as the email address, which is p4pboxingrpt@gmail.com. Let's get the show started tonight, folks. Doing a recap, one main fight, really only one real fight of significance, took place last Saturday on ESPN in Herring, Pennsylvania. To the experts, quote-unquote, so to the betting public, this was considered an upset, as Denis Shafakov stopped undefeated Jamal Herring in the 10th round. Since you are new to the show, Baylor Ingram, I'm going to go to you on this one first to break down this fight. For me, like I said, a lot of people consider this an upset, but when you look from jump, and kudos to Teddy Atlas, he saw it from jump as well. He said that Herring is going to be in some trouble here. And I don't know if Herring was overtrained or if he had issues making the weight, Ingram, but he just did not have it from jump. He seemed stiff. He seemed rigid. The spark, the energy wasn't there. And Shafakov, to his credit, found the target early, put him down at the end of the first or the second round. Every time Shafakov hit this guy, he seemed to hurt him. And it got to a point where it was just Herring fighting on heart, because he had no answers. He had no answers. I personally thought the fight was stopped a round too late. I thought it should have been stopped in round 9 because Herring got pummeled in that round. Are you surprised at the result? And your thoughts on Herring? Some hype coming in, but again, it just wasn't there for him Saturday night.
A lot of things you've got to consider. I think he did look like a guy who was weight trained, first and foremost. Secondly, he didn't seem to get able to get out of the way of the shot Shafakov was throwing, from what I saw on the fight. Am I surprised he got beat? Not particularly. Shafakov is probably a better fighter than people are giving him credit for. The guy, I think, he's had 35 fights and probably one defeat in his, and that was through a world title points loss, I think it was. So the guy has seemed pretty well rounded. Shafakov is a southpaw, tough, strong, sturdy, and that's the sort of guy that you have to come into the fight 100% or 110% in. And it didn't look that way of Herring. I don't know what he was doing before the fight, whether he didn't make weight in time or he struggled to make the weight. The other thing is, I don't know what he was doing in sparring, whether he left his best form in the gym. I don't know. Whether he was ready for a big fight like that, I don't know. What I do know is that Shafakov was in there, and he just, once he caught Herring in that round, I think it's round 2, it just seemed like it was just, well, that's it. I'm on to you now, and I'm just too strong for you. and I'm just going to take you out. And it just seemed like round after round after round after round. And no matter what Herring tried to do, Jamal Herring tried to do, he couldn't find the answer for that. And that's the difference between a fighter that's a good fighter and a great fighter, because a great fighter, even when all things are going against him, he can pull it out of the bag. So, you know, am I surprised? No. And the other question you've got to ask yourself in terms of the matchmakers, was that the result they wanted? I mean, that's an undefeated fighter. I don't know. So there's lots of questions to be asked of not just Herring, but also of the matchmaking.
The thing I will say is that I was doing some live tweeting of this fight the night of the fight, Saturday, and Raging Babe had suggested that he may be overtrained because, according to her, Herring had another scheduled fight, but it was postponed, and then this fight popped up, and he kind of went right back into training. So it could be a case of him being overtrained. I don't know, but he just didn't look strong in the ring at all, Daniel. We talked about this on your show over the weekend. So your analysis of what went down.
When I kept looking at the fight, I saw Herring not use one bit of his natural height and reach advantage that he had against Shakhtarov. He could have used that to stay out of the ring, jab, and keep Shakhtarov away, but he just wasn't. And like I said, we mentioned it on Sunday, there was a sense of feeling where it felt like he was overtrained a little bit. He was a little bit too much spent, especially when it came to the ninth round. That ninth round, he took a beating. And luckily the corner did it a round too late, but they finally did the right thing in the tenth round when they saw Shakhtarov land that left hook again. Immediately they waved the towel. Now, our good guest here, Ingram, mentioned the matchmaking. A lot of it also has to do with the way it was presented. If you pay attention to the ESPN broadcast, because it was on July 4th weekend, they kept bringing up the fact that Herring's a Marine, and one of those characteristics showed up. You literally have to kill a Marine for him to stop. You have to kill him for to stop, or you have to stop things for him. And that's what happened with Herring. Herring was going to go, and it was going to go into a bad place. But I never imagined that with Herring, that you would see him not use his natural advantages at all. It kind of reminded me, actually, a little bit of a couple of Leo Santa Cruz's fights before the Morris fight, where Santa Cruz was taller, and he had longer reach than his opponents, but he didn't use it. And he wound up looking bad. The difference is that Shakhtarov came ready to fight, and Herring apparently did not.
Okay, Gail, Gus, Jacob, your analysis of not only what went down, but moving forward here for Herring, what does he need to do to recover from this? Is it mental? Is it physical, meaning a possible move up in weight? An adjustment in terms of his style. Your thoughts?
Well, Herring does need to move up in weight. Herring is a very, very tall guy to be 135 pounds. And it was pointed out several times during the broadcast, I believe by Teddy, who was in good form. It was good to hear him back, actually. That he's never fought above 135. The guy's 30 years old. You expect someone who was fighting at 20 at 135 to weigh more at 30. So something's going on there that's frankly a little odd. Now, part of it is he's been in the Marine Corps. I mean, you have a pretty wild, fast metabolism when you're working that hard as an active duty Marine. So, you know, that could be part of it. I'd like to see him go up and weigh a little bit. And he needs to really think about changing his approach, because what he's doing now, he can't move forward in the same way and continue to be successful in today's version of professional boxing. But I don't want to be so hard on Herring and ignore the good job Shafikov and his trainer, Abel Sanchez, did with the game plan, using the skills he's got, and executing it perfectly against a much taller guy. He went to the body extremely well. He cut off the ring extremely well. And I can't help but think he was watching stablemate Gennady Golovkin for a lot of those skills. You're going to be in a gym with a guy like that every day. And Golovkin is very much a mentor to the younger, especially Eastern European fighters up at the summit in Big Bear, California. You know, you're around that all day and you see it working as well as it does for him. You're going to emulate that, especially if, you know, you admire him, you consider yourself in the same sort of style, and that's what those guys do. So, you know, due credit to Shafikov. He made that ring really, really small for Jamal Herring. I think he has a future, but he's going to have to sit down and do some serious reassessment. And Shafikov, I'd like to see, you know, him against a guy a little closer to his size. He's always going to be really small in the division. Just, you know, he's 5'5". But I like what I saw.
Gus, Jacob, your thoughts?
Yeah, Mike, like yourself, I was, you know, disillusioned how Jamal Herring was, I think he was the 3-1 favorite coming, you know, into this fight against a vastly sort of experienced, battle-hardened warrior who had only lost two fights, you know, Miguel Vasquez and Bartholomew, both in sort of title fights. And, you know, there's a very nice narrative behind, you know, Jamal Herring. You know, you cannot have tremendous respect for him as a man, as an individual, given his background, and he suffered, you know, some heartbreaking tragedy as well, hence which would sort of motivate him in the ring. But now, although the blueprint was there on how to defeat Shafikov, specifically Bartholomew, and given that Herring's physical attributes almost replicate that of Bartholomew, you know, one would think that it could be implemented, because Shafikov, when he was on the inside with Bartholomew, Shafikov was having a lot better of the exchanges. It's only when Bartholomew made the adjustment in the latter part of the fight where he actually chose to implement some distance and then sort of pot shot him from distance that he was able to have success. But when you're fighting somebody as relentless as Shafikov, who's obviously targeting coming inside, specifically larger man, but unfortunately Jamal was just a little bit too flat-footed. He simply didn't have the power to thwart somebody who's continuously coming forward. And Shafikov's, you know, right hooks during the early part of the fights was having an effect, and we saw that beautiful sort of leaping, sort of shimming southpaw lead right hook in the second round, which had, you know, floored or caused the knockdown. You know, Herring just sort of kept sort of circling clockwise. You know, very, very lazy jab. I saw sometimes when he actually had success with his right hand, he wouldn't step forward. He was almost there admiring his work at times. But one thing as well, Mike, you know, I thought the officiating was just unbelievably, you know, the referee just kept intervening. Now a referee shouldn't intervene. You know, I mean, a clinch is when both fighters are tied up and both hands are tied. But clearly here, you know, if you have one hand free, you should continue fighting and the referee shouldn't intervene. But at every opportunity, he would intervene, break him. And at times, you know, he would physically push the fighters back. So some of them, you know, the worst officiating that I've seen. Yeah, you know, it was unfortunately just looked a very, very lethargic, flat-footed, just had no power to keep him back, and Yeah, so it was a great win for Shafikov, and something I, you know, I would have predicted and disappointed that I didn't put any money down for.
Oh, gamblers.
Jacob, your thoughts?
Yeah, not too much more to add. I think a couple points Ingram made with I think Shafikov was better than advertised. And with Daniel had hit on this, with hearing that he didn't use his height and reach advantage, especially when you get hurt and you know you want to keep somebody off you, you got to use the movement, use your height, use your reach to try to get your bearings back. So I think that was part of his downfall. But am I surprised? It actually reminded me of. I can't remember who the guy was, but there was another PBC undercard fight where I think the guy was from St. Louis, but he was like a highly touted undefeated fighter, and he fought some Eastern European guy, and the guy went through him like a buzzsaw. I want to say Douglas or something like that, but...
I know who you're talking about, but his name escapes me right now.
Yeah, but he was also like supposed to be like this up-and-comer prospect, and then he runs to this guy who just puts on the pressure, and you know, almost the same thing happened.
Okay, indeed. Since it was a rather light week, well, wait a minute, we can talk about this a bit here. I don't know if anybody saw Amir Imam. He finally made his comeback into the ring against a guy, knocking out a guy by the name of Okuna in three rounds. If anybody saw the fight, a comment on it, or if you have not, thoughts on Imam coming back this late? Was it good for him? Was it bad for him? I argue it was a good move for him, but I need to see the fight itself because I haven't seen. I need to see the style, how he fought, and I wonder if he made a change in his corner because. One of my main problems when he lost to Granados was that when he went back to the corner, obviously confused and didn't know what to do, his corner didn't provide him any help. So it wasn't just a thing of how he fought. There was no adjustment there, and that's how he really got exposed. Not just from a mental from a physical standpoint. Not just from a physical standpoint, excuse me, it was a mental and psychological standpoint as well. So any comments on the return of Amir Imam? And I'll just open up for anybody here now to hang out. Unmute your mics, please.
I didn't catch the fight.
I didn't see the fight, sorry.
Yeah, kind of an in-the-weeds event. This was only the third professional boxing event promoted by the new Pinnacle Group at the Teamster Temple in Pittsburgh. There's a high-class venue, right? But, you know, it was a club show, I mean, basically. So, you know, very interesting choice for Miramam to, you know, get in there. One of Don King's heavyweight prospects was also on the card, Trevor Bryan, who I've never seen. So, I'd be interested to see that. You know, the opponent for Imam was described as a overmatched Nicaraguan who was only 16 and 19. So I don't think we should get too excited.
I mean, I will say that I'm always in favor of fighters, especially after suffering a loss, to get back on that horse, get those rounds in. You know, even if it is a smaller show, but you know, try to get your confidence back, try to get, you know, fix the things that went wrong in the fight you lost. So, I mean, to me, it's better to do that than to stay on the shelf and just train.
Absolutely right. And, you know, that gives a fighter, even when they know they're fighting somebody with a losing record, but a guy with 35 fights, so, you know, somebody willing to put in rounds, it gives them their confidence back, even when they know they've got, you know, a make-work fight in front of them, doesn't matter. So that third round TKO was exactly what he needed. But I'm not sure if he's changed personnel or not. That that's worth checking out.
See, that's my that's why I mentioned it while talking about this coming back from Elon. You're right. It is good for him to get back into the swing of things, but if there's no real adjustment there in terms of his style, reconstruction of his style, if you will, my fear is he is going to get in a similar position against a similar type of fighter, or even better, and the result will be the same. That's my fear.
Yeah, but I mean, what's the alternative? He doesn't fight, and, you know, this is their livelihood, right? So, I mean...
Well, the alternative is take your career in your own hands, even if you have to get rid of some folks and find someone new in your corner who can help you out, do that.
Yeah.
But, I mean, I think that's what we all want to happen, but a lot of times, you know, some of these boxers have been with these teams and you know, they build these relationships and they trust in these people to think that they can make the adjustments and the change, and then before you know it, you know, their career is come and gone. I agree with you, that's what should happen, but unfortunately, I don't think that's the reality of what happens a lot of the times. A lot of times these fighters kind of stick it out and then just kind of get into that rut.
You were saying something, Gus, quickly?
Yeah, I was saying that what he really needs, in my opinion, he needs a disciplinarian stroke sort of man motivator stroke sort of some sort of a coach that has defensive capabilities, because he's got the offensive arsenal. I mean, he had one of the best jabs that I saw as well coming up. So, but you're right, you know, he's corner for the Granados fight, you know, where he was, you know, having a lot of success early on, but after that, the instructions just dissipated almost to the extent that they were just sitting down looking at one another with absolutely no instructions being relayed, which was just atrocious. So, you know, you can't blame a young fighter for that. He's corner, you know, obviously they'll have the impetus. They need to be advising him because he's never been in that position before. So quite clearly, yeah, there needs to be some sort of a complete overhaul in that camp. So I'd be curious to see, you know, whether he has changed personnel and who exactly who that personnel is as well.
That's the interesting thing, probably. When the press release came out about this thing, nobody mentioned the training, which was kind of iffy. Part of me tells me that he didn't change anything in his corner, and this was just like a feel-good fight to get back in. Okay, you're ready to step back into the ring. You've recovered mentally, and I see you've got to recover physically from it. But the unfortunate side effect is, I agree with Mike that he might get in the rut if he gets stuck with that same trainer again. He does need somebody that can teach him defensive skills on top of an already decent offensive arsenal. He needs somebody probably like Joel Diaz. Joel Diaz can teach you footwork. Joel Diaz can teach you good defense. And if you already have good fundamentals like your mom has, it makes the job a lot easier for him. The only issue that we have is because he is tied to Don King, Don King may not have the finances to hire Joel Diaz.
Exactly, because Imam and Trevor Bryan, the heavyweight prospect that King oversees, are both training in Florida, in Hollywood, Florida, which is where King's offices are. So, you know, there's perhaps some limit there. I'm a little less concerned about any drastic change before we figure out whether that was just a bad night at the office, you know, a good night for Granados. It's tough to say. I think sometimes we are so shocked when a person like Imam loses, or even Herring, that are considered favorites. You know, first of all, we don't give enough credit to the opponent for the win frequently. You know, it was a failure by the favorite, not a win by the opponent. And that to me doesn't always give credit where it's due. And you have to figure that out. Was it a bad night? Was it your opponent? Were you caught off guard by someone better than you trained for before you completely upend everything that's been working for you up to that point?
He might have even been looking past the fight, too, because wasn't he that fight that he took with Granados,
he was getting hyped like crazy all of a sudden, you know? He if you drink your own Kool-Aid, that's exactly what happens to you. So, you know, every time we hear a boxer utter that cliche of, I'm taking this man seriously, I'm taking my opponent seriously, one fight at a time, all that, you know, we always hear, you know, I always hear, but it's true. They've got to focus on what's in front of them.
Let's go to some news here, since, again, this has been last week was a really light week in boxing. I'll go to you, Baylor, since you're in Ireland, Gus, you are in the UK and England, excuse me. Two main fights involving English fighters that's being talked about, Kell Brook, and then unification Jesse Vargas, and the Nautica Lovkin negotiations happening with Chris Eubank Jr. Nothing's been finalized with both of those fights yet. Your perspective on what's causing the delay? I know there's back and forth talk between Brook and Vargas on the one hand, and then Golovkin and Eubank Jr. on the other hand.
Well, I've got more insight on the Eubank Jr. Golovkin because I spoke to Abel Sanchez about 3 or 4 days ago. I spoke to him when the news first broke out about Eubank versus Glenn Golovkin, and I think we went at it, and he was saying to me how a lot of people believe that Daniel Gill was a dangerous opponent for Glenn Golovkin. He said that Dominic Wade was a dangerous opponent. I said, no, I don't agree with you there. So it was quite a back and forth with myself and Abel Sanchez. Now, I'm in two minds. I think that Eubank Jr. and Gennady Golovkin can fight. I do believe that, contrary to what I may have said before, I do think that it's a live opponent, much more live opponent than a lot of the other guys that Gennady Golovkin is for in terms of Eubank Jr., because he'll come and fight. I don't know whether that's going to help or not, because I've just read today that there's no game plan. He's just going to come out and fight. Well, he's got no defense, Chris Eubank Jr., and he's never been in ring with somebody who hits as hard as Gennady Golovkin. So in terms of negotiations, I couldn't tell you whether the fight's been signed or not. Gennady Golovkin saying, well, you know, it's over to you, Eubank. Eubank is saying, well, yeah, we're ready. It's over to Eddie Hearn, and Eddie Hearn saying something, and I don't know. And then you've got the same thing with Kell Brook and Vargas. Fight seems to be falling through. I heard a rumor a while back that Brook felt that he wasn't getting enough money for the fight. I don't know. I'm very skeptical about mismatch room. I really am. And it comes to Eddie Hearn. He says one thing and something else happens. So in terms of Kell Brook, I'll reiterate this. I think Kell Brook's best thing for him to do is to run down his contract with Eddie Hearn and to get himself over with Al Haymon. And as for Eubank Jr., I hope the fight does happen, to be honest. I think it's going to be a better fight than a lot of people think it will be. But I don't know. I see Gennady Golovkin being just a little bit better than for him. That's what I think.
You hear that, Daniel? You hear that? You know, EJ and I are not the only ones who think that Eubank Jr. is going to give him a fight. I'm just saying.
Yeah, I'm going to play the bias card here. Good old guess Ingram is British, so I kind of expect that.
Well, but I don't expect. Now, I say he'll give him a fight. Now, I don't know if going head on with Gennady Golovkin is going to get him knocked out faster, because he was getting hit with big shots by Spike O'Sullivan, getting hit by big shots by Doran. If you get hit with him sort of cleanly by guys like that, then that's just meat and drink for somebody like Gennady Golovkin. So it could be a real accident waiting to happen. You know.
That's why I say Chris Eubank is going to get mollywopped, because if that's his really game plan, I'm just going to go out there and fight and throw that wide uppercut and try to be cute with somebody like Triple G. Yeah, it's going to be over fast. The problem is, though, is this contract negotiation deal, because, like I said, we've talked about this last week, like how the Brexit is affecting the British pound. I think I saw at one point in the currency table that a British pound was at one point worth now 75 cents US. That's 50% loss of value. So the money maybe that Jesse Vargas thought he was going to get for the Brook fight doesn't look like the same amount of money he's getting now. Or maybe that's the same situation with Eubank and Golovkin. Eubank doesn't see that he's going to get the same money now because it's not worth the same money now. But that's going to be the main issue because, like I said, I'll be honest. Yeah, Eubanks is probably right now the best opponent that Triple G can get at right now.
What about this talk about Danny Jacobs? Danny Jacobs has said, oh, I'll fight now. So does he know that the fight's already been signed, or is he talking big? What is that there?
He's fighting Mora. He's fighting Mora.
He's fighting Mora because the WBA wants to be punks and not order Triple G Jacobs. Okay. And that's the WBA's fault because the WBA decided to step aside and let Canelo Triple G negotiations go through, and then when we all saw what happened, they didn't step in and say, okay, we're going to make our mandatory because Danny Jacobs has been the mandatory for Golovkin for 2 years.
According to Abel Sanchez, he's
Say again?
I said, according to Abel Sanchez, he said that there was a gentleman's agreement and a handshake that Canelo and Triple G will fight in September next year.
Yeah, that's a gentleman's agreement that's going in there. It might get pushed actually to May because there's enough pressure that's going to go into it. The problem is, unfortunately, and especially when it comes to boxing fans that were becoming cynics, we've seen gentlemen's agreements before. We saw it with Donna Stevenson and Sergey Kovalev. And we saw what happened right afterwards.
But both the guys participating in the gentlemen's agreements need to be gentlemen.
But then having said that, you've seen a gentleman's agreement with Andre Ward and Kovalev, and as long as Andre Ward doesn't get injured against Grant, then we're in, aren't we?
That fight's signed, though.
Ward has signed the contract, as a matter of fact.
But, yeah, I mean, if he gets injured by Brad in the Brown fight, like a cut over the eye or something like that, then that puts that fight in jeopardy, does it not?
It just delays it. The thing about it, it's in writing. They're going to fight.
Oh, they're going to fight.
Yeah, it's just a matter of when. If he gets cut, yeah, the fight's not going to be this year. But the fight's going to happen because it's in writing. That Canelo Triple G situation is not in writing.
Canelo Triple G had an agreement when Cotto and Canelo fought. They had a gentleman's agreement, and we all saw what happened there. I mean, it was basically, you know, oh, we need another fight, and then now they're talking about, you know, they need to adjust the weight. So, I mean, I personally don't think that fight's going to happen. But, Daniel, I got to give it to you. I think you came up with Triple G's next T-shirt for his merchandising. What'd you say, the Molly Whopper or whatever you said?
Yeah, Molly Whopping, yeah.
The Molly Whopper. That's going to be his next shirt.
Yeah, no. What's Spanish for Molly Whopper? That's it.
And I also want to add that I being a Brit and actually knowing Eubank and actually be living in the same area as Eubank at one point in time, I should be Team Eubank, but I'm not like that. If I think one guy's going to win, you know, I'm going to say that guy's going to win. I'm not one of these Brits that are biased and says there's no way the Eubank's going to get beat. I mean, you can see if he's getting caught by Spike or Sullivan, just imagine Gennady Golovkin hitting you. That's my concerns. Defensively, I've got a lot of concerns about Eubank Jr. What's he fight when what does he do when somebody's pushing him against the ropes that can punch? Those are my concerns.
Well, and Eubank Jr. is exactly the kind of guy Triple G wants in front of him. Person who will come at him and present a target. And you already see now K2's crew, Tom Loeffler and Abel will do all, and Oleg, I can't think of Oleg's last name, his manager, have already started the whispering campaign saying, well, you know, Eubank Jr., he's the one that called us out. We're all about the fight. Boy, he's taking a long time to sign. You know, is he chicken? And, of course, they're trying to rile him up because they want him so worked up by the time of the fight that he runs right at Triple G. Brilliant strategy. And I guarantee you the chief shit-talker in charge as we get going will be Abel, who has years of experience as a shit-talker. A polite one, but he still will do it. And Eubank Jr. and especially Senior will not handle it well, is my prediction.
Well, he didn't do any of that with me, and when he tried it, he didn't go very far. So the interview's out
well,
there.
He won't really aim it at us. And you know, maybe Oleg was the designee at the moment, at least from the interviews I read. And Abel is very, very polite about it. He's not one of those guys that does it with insults or belittling an opponent. You know, it's more of the pat on the head and the whole good boy thing that goes on.
Let's get Gus into this discussion. Thoughts on ongoing negotiations for Brook Vargas as well as Golovkin and Eubank Jr.
Now, Mike, we've seen Jesse Vargas taunting Kell Brook on Twitter, and I feel justifiably so. Now, the problem here is that Jesse Vargas has signed the contract. The contract was subsequently sent to Kell Brook's lawyer, and the contract is still with his lawyer. And from my understanding and speaking to some people within the camp, the problem here is that Kell Brook is disillusioned that Jesse Vargas is the A-sider in this fight. Matchroom had to concede to Top Rank for a unification fight to take place, you know, in Sheffield. And Kell is a little bit upset that Jesse Vargas is receiving a purse of $1.7 million, with Top Rank receiving an additional $400,000. And Kell Brook's purse is thought to be around $1.1 million. Now, the second problem as well is that an official date for the fight couldn't be confirmed until Sheffield United Football Club had first published their upcoming fixtures for their 2016/2017 league fixtures, particularly the home dates. Now, the club have just very recently published all of their home and sort of away fixtures, so depending on whether Kell Brook will sign the contract, then I'm sure a sort of a rescheduled date or an official date can be set. But there is concerns that Kell Brook is perhaps taking a little bit too long, and Jesse Vargas is saying, well, look, if you're going to continue to procrastinate, then I'm just going to pursue other means in terms of a Bradley rematch. But, you know, this is another problem that, you know, we talk about what Amir Khan has done to Kell Brook. He's not only sort of psychologically sort of destroyed him in terms of baiting him to a fight, which was never going to happen, dangling a huge purse in front of him, and just all along he had absolutely no intentions of fighting him. And hence Kell is starting to have doubts with Matchroom as to whether they can put him in with some of the big fights, because Kell's only option was an offer from Frank Warren, which was £600,000 to fight Liam Smith for the 154 title, and that fight would have been in Manchester, but Matchroom rejected obviously that offer as they deemed it to be derisory. So this fight is certainly looking in jeopardy.
Gus, I have a question though.
Yeah.
Matchroom didn't have a choice in this though, right? Because if Jesse Vargas is going to go out there and just get beat up by Kell Brook, he needs to get paid for it. So he had to get more money than Kell on this.
It's a concession, you know. I guess the concession was, you know, if you want the fight, if you want home field advantage for Kell, then perhaps he's going to have to concede on that part, and maybe rightfully so. You know, Kell, I mean, this is not the first problem. You know, we've seen so many fight. There seems to be some massive problem with Kell. We've seen, you know, the Diego Chavez fight. We've saw the Brandon Rios fight as well. So clearly there is some internal issues there. Whether it's with Kell and Eddie Hearn, who have a close relationship, but from some of the people I know that have been speaking with both, you know, Keanu is starting to have, you know, doubts as to whether, you know, he feels he's not being compensated sufficiently. But, you know, maybe he's got to take, you know, the short end of the stick now for a unification, and then hence later on he'd be in a better position to command that, you know, the higher purses.
What? Anybody, any last words before we move on?
We just seen a similar dynamic to that actually in basketball recently, where a fighter, somebody that's been actually sacrificed by management, just gets tired of it. And it may just be a case. Like I said, I'm in the personal belief when it comes to Caleb Brook that I don't think he really can make the weight anymore. And I do think that, I don't think the Vargas fight's going to happen. I do think that he's going to go straight then now to 154. And then you're going to see the Spence Mundu fight that's supposed to be a title eliminator be for the Bacon IBF title. And then you're going to have Jesse Vargas chase down Tim Bradley for all the sad spectacle that that is.
Yeah. Let's move on. And this episode is named, you know, mid-year report, mid-year review of boxing. We're going to go into that right now. Few categories here, talking fighter of the year, contender, prospect of the year, fights we're looking forward to for the rest of the year, a memorable moment in boxing. I'm going to go to you, Gail, ladies first. Start with your fighter of the year for 2016.
Fighter of the year, not fighter of the year.
Fighter of the year,
Boy, and this to me was absolutely the toughest category because the jury is out on so many of these guys. You know, one good fight could really, really change the lineup for me. This is going to be maybe a bit of a surprising choice, and I think he needs one more good fight to really make it stick. But I might just go with Vasyl Lomachenko as Fighter of the Year. His fight over Rocky Martinez was very impressive, but he's going to need one more good fight. I would also say exactly the same thing about Keith Thurman. He did an excellent job. He put on not just a good fight, but an entertaining fight, which boxing sorely needed. But I think he needs one more fight of that nature or better to be Fighter of the Year this year. And, you know, if he wins and if the fight comes off and Tyson Fury once again beats Vladimir Klitschko, we're going to have a really hard time not calling him Fighter of the Year. But, you know, are we going to get Ward Kovalev? The winner is on the short list, clearly, for Fighter of the Year if that happens. Are we going to get a Gonzalez versus Estrada 2 this year? Winner there, obviously, on the short list. So, you know, this is one that right now it's not a definitive choice like I think there are in many of the other categories we're going to talk about tonight.
Go to you, Gus, and then you, Ingram. Your fighter of the year for 2016 so far. Can you hear me, Gus? Unmute your mic, please, Gus. What about you, Ingram?
Okay, I'm here. There's some really good fighters there that Gail's talked about, and I would have definitely agree with her that it's always that one extra fight they need to make them the fighter of the year. I'm going to go and say a real strange one. I'm going to go with the Anthony Joshua thing, and I'll tell you why. He's fought two undefeated fighters so far. If he can now go on and beat either a Bermain Stiverne at the end of this year or beat even a Parker at the end of this year, I think that would be good. He's fought consistently. He's fought decent enough opposition, unbeaten fighters. And on top of that, his marketability, you know, and the way his career is going, I think I would put Joshua up there as well. Lomachenko, I totally agree with you there as well. I think, you know, he's a guy that's very impressive performance, and then one more good fight would put him up there as well. And then you've got the Keith Thurman fight. If Keith Thurman has another good fight like he had against Porter, or even better than that, scoring a big knockout win against a top five opponent, that would be great. But I think for consistency in terms and profile, and you know, and if Joshua could end with Park at the end of the year, I would give it to Anthony Joshua for consistency and fighting undefeated fighters.
Let me see if you're there, Gus, please unmute your mic. If not, I'll go to you, Daniel, your fighter of the year for 2016. I think Gus is still muted. Go to you, Daniel. Unmute your mic.
All right. So far, my pick, like I mentioned on Sunday, is Anthony Joshua. Because of the potential that you're seeing in the kid, not that you're just beating two undefeated fighters, because when you look at Charles Martin, Dominic Brazil, you kind of take those records with a grain of salt. But it's the potential that you're seeing coming into it. Like, it took literally, what, a combined 2 hours to sell out two fights and the O2 Arena in London? That shows you the drawing power that he has. And yeah, if this rumor is true and he winds up fighting Bermain Stiverne, that's a huge step in class from what he's been facing before. And if he happens to beat Stiverne, then you can say maybe, yeah, he's ready for the Vladimir Klitschko's, the Deontay Wilders, the Luis Ortiz's. But we're going to have to see what's going on. But right now, and at this part of the year, it's Anthony Joshua to me.
I will add that if Tyson Fury does a number on Klitschko again, then I have to put Tyson Fury ahead of Joshua, just because of the magnitude and who he's beaten.
I'm going to go outside the box here in terms of right now, after the taping of the show. My 2016 Fighter of the Year is Krulla, Anthony Krulla, based on his win over Barroso, the fact that he was the clear underdog. A lot of people thought that Barroso would go in there and not just beat Krulla, but would knock him out, would stop him. And the fact that he won, the manner in which he won, the plan and the execution was flawless on his part, and he wore Barroso down, stopped him with a body shot. I can hear you arguing about Lomachenko, but we all knew going in that Lomachenko would beat Rocky Martinez and beat him rather convincingly. Joshua, he is on the ascendant. He is getting ready to become a big star in the sport. But I would argue that Krulla's win over Barroso is more impressive than Joshua's win against either Martin or his last fight against Brazil. And if we're going to talk potential here, what if Krulla beats Jorge Linares, who many consider is the best in the world at 135? Put that up there. I would put that up there against anybody has done this year. So for me, my pick is out of left field, if you will. But right now, I will go with Anthony Krulla. Wait, no pushback? No pushback?
No argument for me. I'm the only one who picked him to win.
Yeah. I would push back by saying Barroso was, I know he knocked out Kevin Mitchell, but Kevin Mitchell never had the greatest of chins, and, you know, we never know how good Barroso really was. The reason why we thought Barroso was great is because he beat Kevin Mitchell. We had nothing else done to back that. So against, when he fought Krulla, it was a good win, but, okay, but I'd like to see Krulla fight somebody else. And if he does beat Linares, which is a totally different proposition, if he beats Linares, then possibly yes, but we'll have to see how he does against Linares.
Fair enough. Go ahead.
Yeah, that's
something.
That's what it was. Yeah, I had to see him against Linares because Jorge Linares is a completely different animal for Barroso.
Agreed.
So the same gameplay may not work, but then again, Linares cuts real easily. So we have to see what's going to happen there. But it's a, like I said, it's a decent argument. It's a good dark horse because let's face it. Yeah, none of us, except I think for likely for Gale, gave Kral a shot against Barroso. So there's a chance. Like I said,
now,
there's merit to that.
Can I throw something in there? And this could be just sure conspiracy stuff. But I heard a rumor that when Barroso fought Mitchell, that he had smaller gloves when he fought Mitchell, and then when he fought Crawley, he had bigger gloves. That's what I heard. I don't know how true that is.
Oh, I don't know anything about that, to be honest with you. First time I've actually heard of anything like that, so I really got nothing
for you. I thought I'd throw that in there as well. I'm not saying that is the case, but it's something that I heard. Not to discredit Crawley's performance, but that's what I heard. And when you hear things like that, you wonder, let me look into that further, which I'm still doing some looking into.
Okay, indeed. I didn't know about that, so excuse my ignorance there. I'll go to you, Daniel. Fight of the year. For a lot of people, it's down to two fights. Salido Vargas, Thurman Porter. Is it those two fights, or is it another fight we're not talking about? So, from your perspective, fight of the year so far for 2016?
You can't take it away right now for Vargas Salido, because we all expected a bloodbath when it came to Vargas Salido, and it topped our expectations of it. It topped expectations when it came to violence. It topped expectations when it came to skill in being involved. It topped our expectations just the amount of drama, because neither guy went down. And there were points in time where Vargas hurt Salido, where Salido hurt Vargas. And it was just a great event. And like I said, unfortunately, Jacob's not here with us right now. But Gale was there too, the StubHub. You could feel the atmosphere there. And it was right after Ali's death. So there was an extra emotional add to it. It's pretty much right now over Thurman Porter, because there was some doubt at Thurman Porter about what fight we were going to get. There was a lot of people that thought that Thurman was going to copy the Kell Brook playbook on Porter exactly, and just and hold and maintain distance and not let Porter smother him. But no, he came to fight. But it just doesn't top, unfortunately, what we saw in Vargas Salido.
I go to you, Baylor. Excuse me, Ingram from Baylor Boxing TV, and then you, Gil.
Okay, I think Thurman Porter for me. I expected that. I expected Porter to bring the fight to Thurman. I expected Thurman to get on the back foot. I didn't expect Thurman to hold, because I don't usually see him holding in fights. So it was a case of whose will would break first. I didn't see the Salido fight, so I can't comment on that, but I'm sure it was a great fight. There was a fight that was actually either on Matchroom or on Frank Warren's Box Nation, and it was with, I think it involved, I think the guy was Conlon. It was a fight that didn't expect it to be a war. Two guys at it, completely went at it. One guy got dropped in the first, the other guy got up, dropped the other guy, the other guy got up. So I think it's the fight that I didn't expect anything of. I had no anticipation or any thoughts of that turned out to me to be fight of the year, as opposed to a big fight like Thurman and Porter, which I expected to be an all-out war. So it's probably one of the smaller fights that was in the UK, which is not talked about that much, is that would be fight of the year for me, because I didn't expect it, and I was on the seat of my pants because I didn't expect that. I didn't tune in to see that. I expected to see one guy walk over and knock over another guy. I didn't expect to see him on his pants having to get up and knock the other guy down and almost get knocked out himself. So that would have been fight for the year for me.
Gil?
There is no doubt in my mind, having sat literally a few feet away from Salido and Vargas, that is the fight of the year. It was not just the action in the ring, as Daniel pointed out. It was the atmosphere, the absolute enthusiasm and elation of every fan there. nobody's butt was in the seat. Everyone was standing for the lion's share of the fight. And you absolutely could not take your eyes off the ring for even a second, or you were going to miss something wild. It was, honestly, it was the most exhausting fight I've ever been at. And I wasn't doing a damn thing except taking notes. It wiped me out. It was everything and more that it was advertised to be. And nobody leaving was horribly disappointed that it was a draw, except for Orlando Salido and Francisco Vargas. So, absolutely terrific. There is something about that venue. We've all tried to figure out what exact kind of alchemy happens there, but it happens over and over and over.
Again, I guess I might have to be contrarian here, because I'm going to go with Thurman Porter. And the reason for that is I did not expect that kind of fight. The prevailing thought was that Thurman would use his movement, his hand speed, and his better skills to outbox Porter and kind of make it an ugly fight. And the fact that from jump he went there, stood in the belly of the beast, if you will, and fought with Porter from beginning to end, that was something. I was impressed by that. The way that Porter ate up shots and kept coming, the way that Thurman, he took the fire and came right back. I mean, towards the end of the 10th, I was a little bit worried about him. I thought he was going to wilt. But he came back strong in that 11th and 12th round. Skill, the combination of skill and action throughout the fight. For me, Salido Vargas, you knew you was going to get that coming in. And yeah, we got it, and we got it. We got that and more. I just give credit in a fight where you expect one thing, you expect it to be kind of boring, and you get action-filled fight. That sways more, in my opinion. So for me, I'm going with Keith Thurman, Sean Porter for my 2016 Fight of the Year so far. And I know I'm in the minority there, but that's my pick. Any pushback, any objection?
Hard for me to buy that. It was one thing I will say about Thurman Porter that gives it some legitimacy in this discussion to me is less the action in the ring, which was very good, no question about it, and how much good it did for boxing at a time it really, really needed it.
And that's the other thing.
And I've been extremely pleased to hear Keith Thurman, who is one smart cookie, saying, I don't want to fight on pay-per-view. I want to go right back on network TV, because that guy is looking toward the future. This is an investment for him, not just in himself, but in the sport, everything. He and Porter drew the biggest television audience in the United States for a fight this year. That is fantastic news. So good for them, and good for Keith Thurman for staying the course.
I'm going to go to you, Daniel. I'm going to kind of put this together. Well, first of all, let me see. Gus, are you there? If you're there, unmute your mic, please.
He might be asleep.
Yeah, he might be asleep. So I'll go to you, Daniel. I'm going to put this combination together. Prospect, contender slash prospect of the year for you in 2016.
Well, that one was tough. You knew it was tough because this was the toughest category for me to pick on Sunday. What up, Gus?
Teamwork.
Oh, man. Because you saw, I still have a four-way tie. With Januzaj, the cruiserweight, Oscar Valdez, Jojo Diaz, and Erickson Lubin. Because all of them look ready. Like, Usyk's going to fight Gawaki for the title now. And then you have Jojo Diaz and Oscar Valdez. Those two are going to be in a collision course sooner or later because they're both featherweights, and they both, when the spotlight was put on them, they shined. And Lubin, he's young, but you can tell the talent's there. You can definitely see him in a world title bout within a year and a half or 2 years from now, in a loaded division nonetheless. But it's pretty tough to break. If I have to break it in, I would probably say right now, I'll probably say Usyk. Because he's actually fighting in probably down low the most exciting division right now in the sport in cruiserweight. That division's is going to get live real soon. And he's going to probably be at the center of it. And he's young, and he can bring the fight. So I'll probably pick him right now with Tony Value. I don't know if I pick him against the Russian. It depends on where the fight is. Because we all know what happens when Russians want to fight in Russia. But that's probably what it's going to be for the moment. I know Oscar Valdez is fighting for a belt, but I'll probably give it to Usyk right now. That's just a small teensy bit because it's a tough category to break.
I'm going to go to you, Gus. I think since you're back, I'm going to give you a chance to catch up here. Your fighter and fight of the year for 2016 so far, as well as you can give your contender / prospect of the year so far.
Fighter / fighter of the year. Oh, my God. Ooh. With the fight of the year, there was one or two in Japan that Yamaguchi was a brilliant fight on the undercard of the Corrales fight. But no, the Orlando Salido Vargas was, as I said before, the best fight I've seen in probably 4 years. Not only was it good, it exceeded expectations. You're talking what, 750 power punches, the best Salida we've ever seen, the best physically in shape as well, hence, he made it a tremendous fight, so undoubtedly that one. Fighter of the year, oh my God. I'll think about that, but I can give you my stroke prospect, stroke fighter if you want.
Okay.
Now, coming into the year, my 2016 prospect of the year, like my infamous top 10, I had Usyk number one, which I compiled at the end of 2015. But going into this year, there's probably two fighters that have probably elevated up to my radar, had very, very good 2016, and will definitely be probably maybe one and two on my list going into 2017. First is the super featherweight, Mario Barrios, who's 15-0 at the moment. He's a 6 feet super featherweight freak of nature. He has everything. I think he's fighting next week or the week after or something.
He's fighting, I want to say, Saturday.
Yeah, okay. Yeah.
He's on ESPN.
Yes. I couldn't remember. I thought it was the 29th or something, but okay. Yeah. But probably number one for me, and I think a guy who's had a brilliant 2016, he's already fought three times this year, is the featherweight Edgar Valerio, who is really exciting me. He's 7-0 at the moment. He made his debut quite a few years ago as a bantamweight, but his progress has stalled a little bit. Didn't have a fight last year, but he's fought three times this year. He's 5'11" as well, and he has everything. I'm very, very excited for this guy. He's, when you hear him fight, you can just hear the thud in his punches. Upright in his stance, he just reminds me so much of Diego Corrales, the way he throws his right cross. So much of Tommy Hearns in him as well. Beautiful left hook as well. Uppercut, he's got everything, this kid. And given his height, he'll go through the weights. And Yeah, and he's only 20, I think he's 21 or 22, so he's still very, very young as well. Golden boy. I've got him under the wraps. I think Oscar De La Hoya's brother is personally managing him as well. So, yeah, really excited for them two fighters going forward.
I'm going to get mine right quick before I go to Gail and Ingram. This was tough. I mean, you can go in the junior middleweight division. You can pick 3 or 4 guys in that division alone. But, you know, I couldn't pick just one, so I'm going to pick two. The first one is current number one contender for Roman Gonzalez's belt. I'm not going to Noah Pham. I'm not going to try to pronounce his whole name because I know I'll butcher it. Undefeated guy, really, really tall for that division. I think that if he were ever to get a shot, which he's not because Gonzalez is moving up in weight, I think he'd give him a really, really good fight. Not saying he would beat him, but I think he'd give him a really, really good fight. Tall, big guy with physical strength and punching power. Some fighters have one thing. Some fighters have power. Some fighters have physical strength. I think Noah Pham has both. And he looks like he can move up 2-3 weights easily. And I think he's only, what, 23, 24? Another guy at junior featherweight is a guy by the name of Jonathan Guzman, who I've seen fight. I've watched his last few fights on YouTube. Highly skilled, quick hands and quick feet, upper body movement, great variety of punches, and has some pop. He's going to fight for the vacant belt. For Frampton's vacant belt, I think later on this summer. So those are my two fighters. I'm very impressed by him. Very, very impressed. He reminds me of Juan Guzman, except he seems more disciplined at this point of his career. So those are my two fighters. I go to you, Ingram and Gail, your contender prospects of the year so far for 2016.
Good choice, Mike.
Ingram?
Ladies first.
Okay, you can, Gail.
I like who I've heard so far, like a lot of those names. I think it will be Usyk, as long and he falls into the category of a lot of our potential fighters of the year. He's got to have that one big win, and I think he gets it. But one name that's not on the list that I would like to add is Gilberto Ramirez. He had a good outing against Arthur Abraham. Unfortunately, he's off the Canelo undercard due to a broken knuckle, apparently. That's really a shame. Hopefully, it heals enough for him to get back in and get one more good bout under his belt for 2016. And if he does, that gives him a very strong case.
Ingram?
There's two guys here. It's between Usyk for me and Errol Spence. Errol Spence, simply because he's got this fight against Bundu, and I think I would stick Errol Spence in tomorrow against Cale Brook or any of the welterweights in the world at this minute in time. But the Bundu fight, I want to see how he does against Bundu. If he knocks over or knocks out Bundu and does what Keith Thurman couldn't do against Bundu, I think that's going to be a good win for Spence. So Spence, and as for Usyk, another their prospect contender, he's going to be challenging Golovkin in his, 10th fight for the WBO Cruiserweight Championship of the World. I think that fight's going to be in September, I believe. I'll be talking to James Elibashir, the trainer of Usyk. I like the way Usyk's looking. The Cruiserweight division, as you know, everyone can punch in the Cruiserweight division. So it's not just about your the fact that you can punch. You've got to have some boxing ability to go with that as well. So Usyk, it's between Usyk and Spence. But at this moment, I'm going to go with Usyk because he's going to be fighting Golovkin next. And Spence's next fight is against Bundu. So that's mine.
Okay, I'll just go around the hangout here. What fights are you looking most forward to as the year proceeds here in 2016? Like of the fights on the current boxing schedule, Which ones are you looking forward to? I'll give mine first. Okay. I'm looking forward to that Usyk Glowacki fight in September. Mm-hmm. That looks to be dynamite for me, the two best cruiserweights in the world right now. I'm looking forward to Gonzalez moving up and wait to fight the WBC champion. His name escapes me right now. I apologize for that.
Quadras.
There you go. I'm looking forward to Crawler and Linares in September as well. Mm. So as of right now, those are the three fights I'm looking forward to the most. Your picks, folks?
Well, I think we can. Do we consider Ward Kovalev Inc.?
Oh, yeah. Ward Kovalev. How can I forget?
Yeah, that's got to be there.
Yeah.
That's,
I'm sorry. My apologies. That's number one, two, and three.
Yeah. I am looking forward to Crawford Postol. Not because I think it's going to be a wildly entertaining fight, but I think it's going to tell us a lot about two guys who are important in that division, so I am looking forward to that.
And yeah, excuse me, Gail, but I know. I will say this: those expecting Crawford to just run over this guy Postol, that's not going to happen. Postol are going to give him a fight, and don't be surprised if Postol beats him. I'm gonna put it out there right now.
I agree with you. As much as I like Terrence Crawford, he is also one of these guys that needs someone to come at him to be at his best. Postol is not going to do that. That Postol is the definition of crafty and crafty smart. He knows how to get the work in and avoid getting hit, and he makes himself an incredibly difficult target. So he's the kind of guy who frustrates good fighters like Terrence Crawford. So look what he did to Lucas Matisse. I think we're going to see maybe not quite as commanding a control, but you're going to see some of that. And the one advantage Crawford has is he, as he does in most of his fights, he takes the first few rounds to observe his opponent in the ring and figure out what approach he needs to take and then execute. He isn't a guy who goes in there with a game plan and sticks to it rigidly even if it's not working. That's just how smart he is and how capable. He's gonna need to shift. It's gonna be like a Borg coming at him, you know, and he's gonna get off one shot and then adjust, and one shot and then he's gonna have to switch again. It's gonna be tough. But perhaps very technical. Perhaps not, you know, the kind of crowd-friendly fight of a Thurman Porter or a Salito Vargas. So, and if any combination, now we already said fights on the calendar, but I'm going to break the rule. Any combination of Vargas, Takashi Miura, Salito, anybody else who wants to bring any of those bad boys, I'm looking forward to. And even though it was a little bit messy of a fight, I am looking forward to the rematch between Soto Karas and Kamagai, which is supposedly on the Canelo undercard.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, that's the discussion.
Okay. Daniel, Gus, Ingram, your thoughts. What fights are you looking forward to?
I'm looking forward to Kovalev Ward 1. I'm looking forward to Glowacki. Usyk, I'm looking forward to.
Wait a minute, you said Kovalev Ward 1. That implies you think they're going to fight again.
I love it. I love it. Excellent. That's what I'm talking about.
You think they're going to fight again?
Oh, I'm sure they will fight again. I'm sure they will fight again. Yeah, so definitely. I think I'm looking forward to seeing Frampton fight Santa Cruz. That's just around the corner. I kind of not look forward to that fight. Eubank Jr. against Gennady Golovkin. I definitely want to see that fight, just to hear what his dad's going to say afterwards.
And before.
I don't know. I think in the heavyweight division, I look forward to seeing Fury versus Klitschko too, but I really want to see Anthony Joshua against Joseph Parker. So that would be it for me.
Well, the question for that is, will it happen in 2016? I think it may happen early 2017.
The fight has to happen before the 8th of January, which is why I think the Parker camp is saying that, you know, let's do the fight as a voluntary as opposed to the mandatory, which commences, I think, on the 8th of November, and they have 30 days to make a deal before the fight goes to Perspid. So I think the Parker camp is saying, look, it's probably insufficient time, you know, and then it's not the most lucrative time to put on the fight, sort of late December, early January, when, you know, when folks were on holiday or, you know, broke or etc. So you're saying, look, honor it as a voluntary, but give us a mandatory contract. So, yeah,
Eddie Hearn's got a special relationship with the IBF, and from what Barry Hearn's saying, November the 9th is Stavern versus Joshua. So, hey.
Indeed. I'll go to you, Gus, and then you can follow up. Daniel, what fights are you looking forward to as 2016 rolls off?
Oh, definitely Usyk. You know, I mean, he's been my man, you know, since the Olympics. But one other fighter, you know, that really excites me is, you know, the Richard Comey and the Robert Easter fight. You know, that's a tremendous fight. Very, very good lightweights, both undefeated. Technically very good, can move, sting, and move.
And both can punch.
Yeah, that's got me really excited, and I'm hoping they can make the Estrada Donny Nientes fight. You know, there's talks about that, so if that can happen.
I'm skeptical at this point. That's been talked about a while now, since at least the beginning of the year, and I mean, it's July already. Will it be made? Well, now that I think of it, now that Gonzalez is moving up, it may well be made, so yeah.
Yeah.
Daniel?
This one's going to be interesting because obviously the Usyk and Glowacki fight is going to be something that you want to circle your calendar on. Even though it's not going to be on US TV, you got to find that stream. Kovalev Ward is definitely the main one. And the issue is going to be, I like Ingram's optimism that there's going to be a multiple fights. I only think there's going to be multiple fights if Ward wins the first fight. Because then main events is going to want to get a rematch for Kovalev. There's, like I said, that fight going on. There's, if we wind up seeing Vladimir Klitschko beat Tyson Fury,
nah,
it would not surprise me one bit if he can go quickly and then fight Luis Ortiz. But, like I said, there's that whole situation with Tyson Fury now that we don't even know, even though the fight is scheduled, we don't even know if that fight's actually going to happen.
But I believe the fight will happen. According to inside information, I believe the fight will happen. I think the fight is going ahead. And the story that came out about the drugs thing with Tyson was from one newspaper in the UK that a lot of people don't have a lot of respect for anyway. So it's more of a witch hunt.
That's the thing, though. The British Boxing Board hasn't denied it. They haven't acknowledged it either, but they haven't denied it either. When you don't acknowledge and you don't deny, just it tells me that there's something going on there. But like I said, we can have that discussion for another day. But I know Vladimir Klitschko's management is trying to push for it. But
Vladimir Klitschko is like throwing stones and you've got a glass house. Vladimir Klitschko, for years people have asked him about his drug, whether he does drug tests. He says, oh, you know, I've been drug tested all the time, but we know that he's probably getting drug tested by his own doctors. So yeah, that's another conversation for another day, but it's very cheeky for Vladimir, who had, obviously, we know about Canvas Gate and Glove Gate and Shoe Gate and everything else Gate with Vladimir, for him to start to around pointing fingers at Tyson Fury, it's quite fresh of him, to be honest.
Yeah, there's a lot of that I know going on with Vladimir. That's right. That's going to be interesting to see if that fight will happen, but definitely the main one is Kovalev Ward. Especially if we get a trilogy out of it. And the only way we're going to get a trilogy out of it is if Ward wins the first one. If Kovalev beats Ward, Kovalev is going to move on, fight whoever lined up next to him, and then try to cower Stevenson into actually getting the fight.
Can I throw something out there, by the way? If Ward beats Kovalev, does anyone think he could move up to heavyweight?
Nope.
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 Good. just wondering.
Check, Jen, check. Speaking of heavyweight, one that I forgot to put on the list, if anybody else said this, I apologize for being inattentive, Luis Ortiz and Alexander Ustinov.
Oh, yeah, that one, yeah, that one's on the Canelo on the card, too. Yeah, that one's
that's correct. Fine. Yeah, I think
Ustinov, he's a big old lump, and I saw what he was doing with Derek Chisora, but, you know, I think that's a great fight, I really do, to see how good. But then again, you know, Ustinov is not the most technically sound fighter, and Ortiz is a very good technical fighter, but I want to see Ortiz with somebody who can crack, who's a bit agile.
I
haven't seen that yet.
Yeah, it's hard to find opponents for Ortiz who are as nimble as he is at that big of a size, which is why an Ortiz-Joshua fight would just be, I'm not sure my heart could take that.
What about Ortiz versus Dillian White? Something like that.
You bet. Anytime King Kong, the real King Kong, gets into the ring, I'm interested.
Well, the interesting part when it comes to Ortiz is, like I said, we all expect him to just demolish Ustimov at this point. Is what's going to happen, let's say, if Klitschko Fury 2 happens and if Fury wins? Because I think Gus is in the same camp as I am that he's in the camp when it comes to Joshua. Tyson Fury's team is not going to let him anywhere near Luis Ortiz, which may force him to vacate the WBA heavyweight title. And that may ultimately cause a completely fractured heavyweight division where you're going to have Joshua maintaining the IBF, Deontay Wilder maintaining the WBC, Luis Ortiz maintaining the WBA, and Tyson Fury with the WBO.
I can answer that for you straight away. First of all, Tyson Fury, should he beat Klitschko, the next fight he'll have is Anthony Joshua. That's the fight that they want. They've said it. I've spoken to Tyson about it. He has no interest in fighting Luis Ortiz. He doesn't think he brings any money in. He also thinks that who cares about Luis Ortiz, and why do I want to fight a guy that's difficult, and why do I want to fight a guy like that? But his argument also was Luis Ortiz did nothing in the amateurs. He was like the second or third amateur heavyweight back then. So his argument is now, why would I fight Luis Ortiz? What does he bring to the table? I would fight Anthony Joshua next, should I get past Klitschko. So Klitschko still controls Tyson. Don't be fooled. Klitschko still controls Tyson Fury. Until he beats Klitschko, Klitschko's still got a hand on those belts that Fury's got.
That's getting interesting. If Klitschko wins, face Ortiz. He'll face Ortiz.
If he wins, he's more likely going to fight Joshua.
No, they're gonna wait on that one. They're gonna wait on that one. K2 is actually smart in this case.
You know that Klitschko has beaten Joshua up quite badly in sparring. So I think Klitschko might take that one.
I knew they sparred, but I hadn't heard any reports on how it went. So
yes, and I think Klitschko would take that in a heartbeat based on what he knows of Joshua, and he sparred Joshua. He never did get spar Fury. I think that was a key thing as well there.
Yeah, but the thing is, Klitschko is also known for fighting mandatories. And we all pretty much expect Ortiz to become his mandatory. So I can see that fight with Ortiz, and it's easier to make because they're both in the HBO camp.
Okay. Klitschko may want to become undisputed champion again. Who knows? So, you know. Who's the WBA champion at the moment, by the way?
It's Fury.
No, the WBA champion that the title that Lucas Brown had.
Oh, Chekov. Chekov has it still. Now he has to fight Aquino.
Chekov's got the title back.
Yeah.
Oh wow.
Ah, I didn't know that. Oh yes, he does have that title back. So, yeah, you're right on that. So, none of y'all looking forward to Julio Cesar Chavez Jr. comeback, huh?
Don't even Damn it, Mike.
Oh, what about Briggs Hay? Briggs Hay, people. What about that fight, David Hay and Shannon Briggs?
Oh God,
that's a circus. More than a fight.
Yeah. Oh,
if Briggs lands.
Oh my God.
That's gonna be a spectacle upon a spectacle, and the interesting thing is, I don't know if you know this, and Mike and everybody else. Apparently, Steve Kim asked Freddie Roach if he will just let, because apparently, supposedly, it's the weight issues again with Chavez Jr. They're delaying the fight.
Oh, that's a huge surprise.
Yeah. And Steve Kim literally asked Freddie Roach, why don't you just let him fight a cruiserweight? Freddie Roach laughed, but he told him, I'm serious. Why don't you just let him fight a cruiserweight?
Yeah, and then he can all eat all the damn Twinkies he wants. Party all he wants.
I mean, he probably comes in at cruiserweight. He's been coming in at cruiserweight in the ring, what, his last 4 or 5 fights? So.
Yeah, pretty close.
Dad will disown him totally.
180.
Is that pretty much already disowned him already?
And I know. Yeah, that's the truth. That is the truth. God, give it a break. he's posting pictures of himself tonight on the interwebs. I try to avoid him. He stalks me, I swear to God.
One last question before we get to the preview. Not necessarily the fight or fighter of the year. The most memorable moment in boxing for me is it can only be one thing. That's the passing of Muhammad Ali, who meant so much to boxing, both in and out of the ring. Worldwide event. His memorial, his funeral was shown all over cable news here, all over the world. I mean, past guest EJ Boxing Live, they did a bit of a tribute over where he resides. I know others within the boxing community did their own thing. I'll go to everybody here, give their thoughts, but for me, the most memorable moment in the sport so far has to be the passing of Ali, and as a bit of an extension, what made Salido and Vargas such a memorable fight was the 10-count tribute that they did prior to the fight, as well as Salido coming to the ring, his ring walk donned in Ali gear from head to toe. But I'll just go from everybody else here. Your thoughts?
I would certainly call that the most significant moment in boxing, without a doubt, and memorable outside the ring for sure. And it made us all consider the recent history of the sport, the players in the sport, what really matters in the sport, and gave us a lot of food for thought going forward. I couldn't disagree.
Gus, Daniel, Ingram?
I would say, obviously, Muhammad Ali's passing, and I think when we kind of, today's TBE, or his self-proclaimed TBE, when you think about Floyd Mayweather promoting himself as the best ever, and then you look at the greatest as Muhammad Ali, it's like day and night in terms of what Muhammad Ali stood for, what he said, what he did for his people, what he did as a man around the world, and people still, years and years after his death, people still talk about Muhammad Ali. I just wonder with TBE whether it will be the same with him when he passes. I think Ali's a class of his own, and I don't think there'll ever be another one like Muhammad Ali. And with the tribute I did, James Ali Bashir did with me on and Muhammad Ali, kind of made me realize just how great the man was at the time, what he was doing. And then I recently was in Chicago. I was able to look at the house that he once was in, and it was just a stunning moment and then only days after he passed away. So, yeah, Muhammad Ali, without a shadow of a doubt. And the other moment would have been when Fury and Wilder got in the ring and kind of looked like WWE moment.
I will baptize you. Yes.
Yeah, I will baptize. That moment as well made me realize, could the sport be changing in terms of how we sell fights? It looked more like a WWE moment there rather than an actual boxing moment, and we're looking at maybe potentially two big heavyweights, one from the US and one from the UK, like the old days, clashing once again. So that's an appetizer for the future, the big men, which is where it's really at in boxing, as they say. So that's the future, and obviously Muhammad Ali's passing.
Gus, Daniel? I think Gus is going out again. Go ahead, Daniel.
There's no question it's Ali's passing, because it wasn't one of the most defining moments in boxing. It's been the most defining moments in sports in American history. Because nobody has either tried or has been able to fill Ali's shoes when it comes to what he stood for overall. The closest person that might have gotten to was Michael Jordan. Michael Jordan chose economics over social activism. Nobody else has come close. Like I said, not Michael, not LeBron, and not even some new athletes coming in today. It was a big blow. It dominated all news for that entire weekend. And it's just a sad, an ending of an era like that. Everybody was not prepared for that one, even though we all expected it. We were not prepared for it. And that's, yeah, there's no question. It just dominated so much of the landscape, not just in boxing, but in overall news, that I don't think any event can come close to a real close second to it right now. Not for a few years down the line.
Let's see if Gus is there. You there, Gus? I don't think Gus is there right now, so we'll move on.
I am going to add one more moment. Mm-hmm. One category we didn't bring up, which should be easy for us all to run through, which provides some of those oh my God moments, is upset of the year. Upset of the year. We've had a few. Joe Smith Jr. over Fonfara.
I'm sorry. I should have included that category.
Crazy
year. I absolutely agree. Upset of the year.
Luke Faller, part-time guy, union construction worker from Long Island, gets it done. Good for him. And what's very important is he needs to get right back in the ring, and he could become a real fan favorite in the United States and elsewhere, for that matter.
Anybody else on that? Anybody disagrees? Yeah, I forgot to add that category, but you're absolutely right, Gil. Smith Jr., his first round knockout over from Flora. Any disagreement here with in terms of upset of the year? Everybody unmute your mics, please.
No argument on that one from me.
Sorry, Mike, what was the... Just come back. What was the question?
We were asking... First, I was asking the most memorable moment so far in boxing, and then we were asking upset of the year, and I see Mike Money, Michael Boyce has joined us. Thanks for joining us, brother. But back to you guys. We were asking your most memorable moment so far of the year and your upset of the year so far in boxing.
I mean, upsets of the year, I think it pretty much started off with Hugo Ruiz when he sort of upset Julio Cejar in their second fight, and certainly the manner of the defeat, you know, that was a surprise. Also,
more than a Fonfara loss?
In sort of just going through chronologically in just some of the other fights, certainly the Joe Smith fight, you couldn't imagine a first round, a KO in that manner, absolutely. But also the Amnet Ranranga being beaten by Casemiro as well, you know, ending his undefeated, and that was a shock as well. But the one that really stood out for me was the you know, the Jezreel Corrales upsetting Uchiyama, you know, sort of an unknown fighter from Panama.
Nice pick.
Who obviously had problems. I think he made weight on the fourth attempt as well, so there was concerns about his conditioning coming into the fight. Fighting obviously in Tokyo as well, and upsetting a fighter who sort of long reigned for whatever it was, 7 years or etc. So, and pretty much just annihilating him as well. So, that was one that put a smile on your face, although it was a massive upset.
Indeed, it did. Indeed, it did. I can't lie about that. memorable moment for you, Gus, so far in boxing. Could be an event, not necessarily a fight or whatever. I chose the passing of Ali, but your thoughts on that? I think it was Ingram. He picked also the kind of back and forth between Fury and Wilder after in the U.S. in which Wilder infamously said, "I will baptize you." Your thoughts?
Yeah, certainly when he gate crashed his fight with Spilka, that was definitely one of the most memorable moments. You've got to do that when you're potentially fighting an opponent. You've got to, you know, and give credit to him. You know, I mean, he attended the fight. He went over there and he got in the ring and I thought that was from a sort of an entertainment stroke sort of prospect, promoting a fight, etc. We like the beef between the fighters as well, you know. So that was definitely a philosophical sort of moment of the year.
I'll go to you, Michael Boss. I just give you quickly an opportunity to give your picks right quick between fights and fighter of the year. Your prospect / contender of the year. What fights are you looking forward to for the rest of 2016 and your upset of the year?
Upset of the year thus far has to be, and you just mentioned it, that Fonfara fight. He went into his hometown of Chicago, I believe, and knocked him out. That was surprising because on the previous podcast I mentioned, I wanted him to get a title shot. He got caught with a couple of great right hands. That's my upset of the year. Fighter of the year thus far for me, and I've been thinking about this all day. I've been really thinking about who I'm going to put as fighter of the year thus far. And surprisingly, I've been going back and forth. And this is why I'm going to say Manny Pacquiao. But for me, that Manny Pacquiao and Timothy Bradley fight, top two at 147, really going at it. And as of right now, because, you know, that within the next coming months, that's going to change with the landscape, especially at 175 and the other divisions when the fight, the best fighting the best. So that's going to change definitely by the end of the year. But thus far, I have Manny Pacquiao right now, but I know that's going to change. Most memorable moment, obviously with Muhammad Ali passing, his home going. But I'm going to take a little different spin, and my memorable moments are not positive with boxing. It's just the consistent and unfortunate, like people missing weight, and I'm gonna go to one fight in particular. It was Lemieux and De La Rosa, I believe. He missed it by 3 pounds. De La Rosa, I believe, it was about to have his newborn, or just had his newborn son or daughter, I believe, and he had to cancel the fight. It was memorable for me because of the actions that Golden Boy took after that, in a sense. you reward David Lemieux with an undercard fight with Glenn Tapia. And memorable in the sense that these are the things, and I'm a fan, and we're all fans, these are the things of boxing that should not be happening. And with with Wilder missing that check, with Povetkin in that major fight, unfortunately, this is the land. I mean, this is what's going on in boxing. I don't like it. None of us like it. I mean, it's memorable for me because it resonates with me so much. The boxers work so hard to make weight and stuff and things of that nature, and these fights are not happening because of the irresponsible actions of these fighters and we have to, as me included, we got to hold these promoters to the fire more when it comes to stuff like this, because you're taking bread, you're taking chicken out, you're taking money out these boxers to help, you know, support their families and stuff like that. It's been a great first 6-7 months of boxing. The two fights I'm most looking forward to, one is next week in 2 weeks with Terrence Crawford and Victor Postol, and November 19th with Andre Ward and Sergey Kovalev. Can't wait for those. Those are the two big fights that I've been looking for the rest of this year. And plus the Showtime cards are pretty good too. Branson and a whole bunch of other fights as well.
And I'll just ask one final question for here, everybody here. Knockout of the year in 2016 so far.
Lomachenko over Martinez.
Mm-hmm. Everybody else?
Khan versus Canelo.
Yeah, Canelo Khan. Just the brutality of that knockout.
And I knew it was coming. It was only a matter of time before it happened. And there were so many people who thought Khan's speed was going to prevent him getting caught. And I just said it was only a matter of time before Canelo caught him. And just then when he caught him, just the image of Khan laying out on the canvas like that and then Canelo going over to him to make sure he's okay, that was brutal knockout. And then, obviously, Lomachenko's knockout win as well was pretty good.
Wait a minute. There were people that were saying that Khan's speed was going to prevent him from being hit.
Absolutely. I tell you, the amount of hate I was getting on my channel for it, unbelievable.
Well, now, have those people ever seen an Amir Khan fight before?
Exactly. He's got all that speed. He still gets nailed by Danny Garcia, who's hardly, he's one of the most flat-footed fighters I've ever seen in my life. But, you know, he's still got nailed by him, and he got nailed by Maidana. Maidana looked like Sugar Ray Leonard. So, I mean, you know, but anyway, that's Khan supporters, and I'll probably get a lot of hate for it again, but it was only a matter of time.
You know, and the reason I didn't pick that is because, come on, what else did we expect? Really? And it was impressive, and being there, there was a significant hush in the audience of concern when it happened, because Amir was down, and he was out cold, eyes open, out cold. What I liked about the Lomachenko knockout is how artful it was. He set that up by hitting Martinez with an uppercut to put his head up in a higher position for then to him deliver the final blow. It was gorgeous.
Gail, have you ever listened to Sky Sports commentary?
Do I ever listen to it?
If you listen to Sky Sports commentary during a fight, you know, Khan's doing well, he's doing great, he's throwing great combinations. Oh, he's been caught! I'm like, yep, Khan's doing well. He's going to get nailed. When's he going to get nailed? Now? No, I'm just waiting. He saw the lazy jab, boom! And then just on the talk before the experts, Khan's speed, his boxing ability, he's going to box him, he's going to do this, I said, this guy's going to get nailed, and when he gets nailed, he ain't getting up. So when it happened, it was like, it's just the impact of that knockout and how all those people before the fight were saying Khan was going to do all these amazing things, then you see him get completely stretched. So I mean, I got a lot of hate for that as well beforehand.
Oh man, you should have heard HBO's... HBO's broadcast in the Garcia fight.
Oh, yeah. Dear.
That was, oh, God, that was atrocious.
Michael, Gus, your thoughts on Knockout of the Year?
I really love the and it comes down to two. Everyone mentioned, you know, the Lomachenko Martinez knockout, and then I was at a bar in New Jersey with the homie Isha. We saw the Canelo Khan knockout together, and the whole bar erupted except for myself. I just looked there and just, I'm like, everyone's celebrating, you know, Amir Khan's chinny self getting knocked out. So to Ms. Gale's point, I like the odds, the, you know, the authorship of the Lomachenko knockout, so I'm going with Lomachenko, with Canelo just right behind that.
If you're around, Gus, your thoughts?
Yeah, Mike, in for a left hook knockout of the year in terms of part of the combination was the left hook that Tony Bellew landed on Ilunga Makubu, which was just at the tip of, you know, the tip of his jaw, you know, just beautifully delivered, and you know, that was the punch that sort of knocked him out before the straight right hand almost flatlined him sort of through the ropes. Body shot knockout of the year was definitely John Real Casimiro's. That remember that left hook, that left that almost decapitated M. Not Ron Rang's body. Yeah, that was a tremendous body shot knockout. But in terms of the package, definitely sort of Vasile's and Gale sort of articulated why it was so good, because, you know, anybody can throw a haymaker to knock somebody out. You know, the law of probability will say that, you know, you eventually connect. But Lomachenko's was impressive because, you know, the power was generated by precision and timing, and it wasn't inertia or sort of, you know, widening the stand to sort of sit down on the punches. It was just, you know, meticulous and the skill to sort of exemplify and sort of execute that. You know, there's only an elite few who could have undertook that. So probably that one as an all-round complete package.
I know that, first of all, a few contenders the one, I think it was Casimiro, that's a contender. I think Tete, his last fight, the body shot that ended it, the beautiful way he set that up, and the execution was flawless. Lomachenko, of course, the way he destroyed Rocky Martinez. But I'm going to go with Canelo, knockout over Khan. I mean, look, we all know Khan has a China chin. But still, the way that he went down, that was scary, even for an Amir Khan knockout. You know, I thought he was seriously hurt. Most of the time when Khan gets stopped, he's usually right back up and pretty much recovered. He laid flat on the canvas for a good while. So for me, I'm going to go with Canelo Khan.
And you know what's funny? Mm-hmm. He caught him with the same move he caught Kirkland with. He looked like he was gonna, he was like he was gonna go low, and then he just, it was like he was throwing a fake, then he just caught him with that hook, and he hit him with the exact same punch that he knocked out James Kirkland. And it was just that, I mean, I don't like Canelo that much, but that's one of his strong attributes. He comes low, then he goes high, and he caught him with that same punch. So that, I mean, that was some beautiful boxing, even though you know how chinny Amir Khan is.
Can I ask a question very quickly? Which one was more brutal, Marquez over Pacquiao or Canelo versus Khan, the knockout?
For me, it was Marquez and Pacquiao. And I have a personal rule that anybody who falls forward from a knockout, that is as bad as it gets. When you go forward, you don't even have momentum going backward. And Pacquiao, honest to God, I don't ever remember being so alarmed for a fighter who was down ever after seeing that. And to this day, having seen Pacquiao, having interviewed him, having been in news conferences with him since then, I still watch it, and I still gasp when I see it.
That, yeah, it's the same thing, yeah, because with Canelo, we all knew it was coming. It was just a matter of when. This, the Marquez knockout came from nowhere. And just the way he fell down, just the way his wife was screaming, just trying to check to see if her husband is okay. That's probably, yeah, that was a little bit more jarring because, like I said, we never seen Mark, up to that fight, we never seen Marquez being capable of doing that to Pacquiao. We knew Pacquiao was able to knock down Marquez, possibly try to knock him out, but we didn't think Marquez had that in him until then.
Two more bonus questions here. If you had to make a prediction for the rest of the year, even an upset that people do not see coming, what would that be? That's the first question for everybody. The second question, on January 1st, 2017, who do you think would be the who do you think will be considered the best pound for pound fighter in the world?
I think we're going to, shall we predict Vargas over Brook? I don't think I could do that to anybody. I do think we're going to have Sergey Kovalev be the pound-for-pound fighter of the year by the end of the year. I think that's a very easy call.
Anybody else?
I would possibly, if I was going to call upset of the year, I would take Glowacki versus Usyk. Because it's such a great fight, but not a lot of people are giving Glowacki a chance, but his heart and his guts, and he can punch in the cruiserweight division, it would be a big upset if Glowacki were to beat Usyk. So I think that would be an upset there, and it's a potential upset on the cards. And the pound for pound number one in 2017, I'm going to stick my neck out and say Andre Ward.
Oh, okay. I am going to amend. If it gets on the books, so there's an if, there's a caveat to this one. If Gonzalez Estrada 2 gets on the books, it could be Chocolatito instead of Kovalev. But I think Kovalev actually still, assuming both would win, I think the edge still goes to Kovalev.
Oh, the prediction so far for the second half. Probably the biggest prediction that I'm probably going to throw out there, at least that I can think of, is we're going to have a fractured heavyweight division by the end of the year. Where we came from just one fight from having completely unified to being completely fractured. And it's either Kovalev or Ward going to be number one on New Year's Day. Whoever wins that fight is going to do it. Unless Chocolatito fights Cuadras and or Estrada or Inoue, that's going to be a tough thing to break.
Gus, Michael?
Upset of the year?
Your prediction. Your going out there prediction for 2016 for the rest of the year. Your bold prediction, put it this way. Yeah.
I'm pretty much in agreement with everyone insofar as upset. I'm gonna look on the PPC side. If you know, every week you turn around, there's an upset there. So, let's see. I mean, oh boy, that's a tough one.
Did I stump y'all with that question?
Did you stump me with the upset one? You definitely did.
Speaking of PBC, would we consider Thurman over Danny Garcia an upset?
No.
See, I would not.
No. I would not.
Some would, but I do not.
I do not.
First, we have to, get Angel Garcia in the room away so that Danny has no choice but to fight Thurman. But as long as Angel Garcia is alive, his son is just going to face more Salkus.
Are you saying the bold prediction is someone puts a hit out on Angel and they get him out of the way?
Well, he is from Philly. And his son ain't exactly liked in Philly, so.
Yeah, well, we'll see.
Okay, here's a couple of bold predictions. By the end of the year, one of my favorite fighters, Alana Tete, will be a world champion. And you will hear talk of him, talk that he should be once amongst the best, amongst the top 10 fighters in the world. I think Usyk will be a world champion by the end of the year. I think towards the end of the year, you will hear words that there will be a unification bout in the heavyweight division. What else? I think towards the end of the year, the rumors that Inoue will fight in the United States will be a fact. And as far as who will be pound for pound fighter, January 1, 2017, Andre Ward. I agree with Ingram here. I know Ward is the underdog coming in, but I think he finds a way to beat Kovalev somehow. But I think he's going to do it. That's my predictions, and that's who Andre Ward. I got him number one now. When 2017 hits, I still think he's going to be number one pound for pound fighter in the world. Your thoughts, Gus?
Upset. I'm going for Arreola knocking out Deontay Garbage Wilder.
Stop it.
Whoa, yeah. Stop
it. Lennon Bundu beating Errol Spence by witchcraft.
Stop it. Again, stop it.
That was two upsets I would dearly love.
Okay, not ones that you actually think will happen, just ones that you actually want.
No, what's wrong with the hey? You might as well just go out on a limb. Who knows? Everything's possible right now. Everything.
And David Havey knocked out as well with Yotes.
Actually, I would love to see that. I would love to see David Haye.
I'll be there for that. Don't worry about that.
I'd love to see David Haye get knocked the fuck out. I would like to see Terry Flanagan get knocked the fuck out permanently out of the sport. But
no, that's just bitter hatred, you know.
Oh,
you know,
hate, man.
If I had a prediction for 2017, that would be Roman Gonzalez is going to lose.
I think that's possible. I do think that's possible. I think my bold prediction is that Adrian Broner is going to do something even more stupid before the end of the year than he already has. And I leave the categories open for him to choose.
Wait, okay, so stupid than, even stupider than beating up somebody in the bowling alley and possibly going to jail for 25 years for it.
Yes, I think so, because that felony didn't stick. I think the next time it will stick as a felony, whatever the hell he goes off and does. And it couldn't happen to a more deserving asshole.
Now, here's the prediction for Broner. He fights Danny Garcia later on this year. Not only does he fight him, he beats him.
He fights Pacquiao.
Oh! No, I don't think he's going to fight Pacquiao.
He's not fighting Pacquiao.
Not this year.
That's my Broner prediction. He gets a fight with Garcia, and when he gets the fight with Garcia, he beats him.
I think he gets a fight and he can't make weight, and that falls in the stupid category.
No, I think he's going to get some journeyman, try to get a feel-good fight, and then he gets knocked out.
What about the heavyweight champion of the world, Tyson Fury, having all his belts stripped from him?
Oh, Gus could go on a tangent on that one.
Yeah.
What would happen to the heavyweight division then?
Boy, wouldn't that be a firestorm? Holy shit.
Well, the only thing that would happen is Klitschko gets his belt back. And then Klitschko's going to fight Ortiz. And then it's easier than to make Wilder Joshua.
Right. And then the winner of that fight gets Klitschko. And if he wins, he goes out in a blaze of glory.
Yeah.
And if he doesn't win, he still goes out.
Wow. Interesting.
Yeah. That would be something, by the way.
And if Sharon Briggs were to knock out David Haye?
Oh, no, I would literally yell in my house somewhere, "Let's go, champ. Let's go."
I think we'd all have to hop on a hangout quickly and chant in unison.
Perhaps
we should prepare right now.
I don't see that happening, but okay.
Okay. If Briggs lands on the chin of David Haye, what happens?
We don't know. That's the thing. But this is the interesting thing about David Haye. David Haye has spent about the last 3 years trying to condition his body to be a heavyweight.
Mm-hmm.
And Briggs, as laughable as a challenge as it is his toughest opponent.
Here's the deal. Haye's going to do any and everything possible to avoid the power for the first 3-4 rounds. And then after that, Briggs is done. Because he can't keep up the pace.
Yeah.
He's going to get nailed if Bonnaruz can nail him, if Valiyev can nail him, and remember, he's a bigger version now, so he's going to be a lot slower. Let's hope that he loses all that extra muscle, and we don't know how much effect that will have on Haye either, so I don't know.
It would be pretty deserving. That way, because then all this little talk about Haye and Joshua could die.
Wow. Could you imagine if Briggs were to knock Haye out?
You really wishing this would happen, don't you?
Well, I mean, if he did, I mean, he would have knocked out a top five heavyweight. I mean, he's in the top five now, David Haye. Don't ask me how he got there, but he's a top five heavyweight now. So if he were to cause a sensation and knock out David Haye, so he would have fought a top five heavyweight, why would he not get another shot at a heavyweight championship of the world?
Exactly.
And with a fragmented heavyweight division, what about him versus someone like Chagaev?
No, because Chagaev has to face Oquendo because of a lawsuit.
Okay, all right. Well, next year then, trying to play devil's advocate. Or
give him a Deontay, I'm saying. Yeah, feed him to Deontay.
Deontay Wilder versus Shannon Briggs 2017. Briggs coming off a shocking win over David Haye and is going to challenge Deontay Wilder. Or Chris Arreola, should he cause the upset against Arreola versus Shannon Briggs. Arreola knocks out Deontay Wilder. Arreola, Briggs for the heavyweight championship of the world.
That would be laughable. Now, like I said, Gail knows that I call Chris Arreola everybody's fat cholo friend.
So, hey, he's my he's one of my neighbors. He's the Fighting Pride of Riverside.
Briggs versus Arreola. Oh, hell no.
Wow. I mean, come on. Okay, that's disastrous, but come on.
No.
He's literally a fat cholo.
You don't help him.
He can punch. And we know Wilder's chin is not the greatest, and he can punch. And Molina made Wilder do that little chicken dance. So if Arreola can land, game on.
He has a puncher's chance. He knows he does.
Absolutely.
And if he wins, he'll buy a round for every single person in the place.
I mean, again, Wilder would use his athleticism to avoid the punches of Arreola. And by the fifth, sixth round, Arreola would be dead tired. And Wilder will strike.
Let's hope that happens, just like with Briggs and Haye. Let's hope that happens. Because if it doesn't, we'll be looking at Briggs versus Arreola.
Well, if you think about it, though, Wilder's a better fighter than when he faced Molina. So he's learned a little bit of the mistakes, kind of it. The mistakes that he faced in the Molina fight. It's the only thing that Arreola has is a puncher's chance, but
look at the Spilka fight. He didn't look great. I mean, Spilka was doing well in that fight.
If Stiverne can hurt Arreola, think what Wilder would do if he lands, particularly with that big right hand. Come on now.
The only thing that makes it interesting is the attitude of a truly desperate opponent, and Ariola knows this is his swan song.
And as for that right hand of Wilder, I said to a lot of people, I said the right hand of Wilder isn't as big as everyone's saying it is. He took how many rounds to get rid of Svilka? He took how many rounds to get rid of the guy he fought before? And he took 7 rounds or 8 rounds to get rid of Molina? Molina got sparked around, who was it? Ariola knocked out Molina in a round. So that big right hand you're talking about, I'm not one of those guys who jump on the
back. And he couldn't finish Bermain Stavern, who had a cell degeneration disease.
Well, there you go. So I mean,
well, here's the thing though. This is the thing though in Wilder's favor. Molina and Duapis, we don't know what Spilker's gonna do next, but Molina and Duapis have gone on to do better things. Think about it. Eric Molina retired Thomas Adamek in Poland. And
he was finished anyway.
Yeah, but no, you think you were gonna get away with that? You think you were gonna get away with that?
Don't get no credit for that. I'm sorry.
No, I do. I do when you're in a country in Eastern Europe and you're not
as native. The knockout win that Duhapas had over
Hellenius.
That was a good win.
Yeah.
Based on the fact, but Hellenius was then, back then, was rated as the heir to the Klitschko's, but he had that injury, he was out of boxing for a while,
yep.
Came back, he hasn't looked as good, so you take those garbage. Things all in. Yeah, he looked garbage tonight, so.
Yeah, well, let's put it to this way. At least, luckily, Wilder cannot be as garbage as David Price was. David Price.
There's another point here. This David Price thing. David Price got beat by Tony Thompson, who Tony Thompson at the time was ranked number 2 in the world, and he got beat by Klitschko. So to get beat by a crafty southpaw who was Tony Thompson, who a lot of the heavyweights didn't want to fight, that ain't bad. That ain't bad considering it's Tony Thompson. Tony Thompson wasn't a bum. Tony Thompson was ranked higher, and he gave Klitschko a lot of problems in the first fight. So I'm not sure about the Tony Thompson Price thing there. And Price never looked good against southpaws anyway. So, you know, I have to go back to his amateur days. Price, he's got that right hand here. Don't write Price off yet. Don't write him off yet. Not
Dave
yet.
Dave Caldwell will do something with him. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That right hand is still one of the biggest is one of the biggest right hands in heavyweight boxing at the moment. And only takes one from Price. So he's not out yet.
It takes one from almost everybody in the heavyweight division. Like I said, that takes one from Wilder. It'll take one from Klitschko. The only one that I haven't seen that's been somewhat impressive has been Fury. But Fury uses different aspects of boxing to win. He doesn't use so much his power.
Mm.
He may be forced to now, I guess, a motivated Klitschko, but that's going to be a different... We have to see that fight in order to actually judge it.
I think we're all in heavyweight Disneyland right now. So for all you listeners, we apologize.
indeed. Let's start this close the show down, previewing the fight that's happening on a Monday. Monday. Big time boxing on a Monday. A fight's happening in Russia. Sergey Kovalev fighting in his home country against Isaac Chalimba. Good contender. Problem is, I don't think he can beat Kovalev. I don't think he can give him much of a good... I think he can give him a decent fight, but Kovalev should prevail and prevail in a relatively easy manner. Quickly, everybody, your thoughts on this?
You said everything that needs to be said.
He better not lose against Chalimba, else that Ward fight is out of the window.
Yeah.
Kovalev's not going to lose a home game. No. Going to catch him with that jab, a straight right hand, and then we're gonna go to November 9th.
It's a victory lap for him.
Yeah,
it's a victory lap for Sergey, and you know, good for him for being in front of his hometown fans. I think that's a very positive thing, even if it is a cakewalk.
Yeah, it is gonna be a cakewalk.
Say again. I'm going Sergey Kovalev by brutal knockout. To be honest, he's gonna look impressive. I think.
Are you calling around? I didn't hear around.
I don't know about around. He'll knock Chalimba out. As if he'll knock Chalimba out. He'll do what Tony Bellew couldn't do.
There you go. And luckily, when it comes with Kovalev, like I said, there's a lot of aspects to his boxing game that a lot of people don't pay attention to because obviously the knockouts are, they're pretty much the equivalent to home runs. Everybody loves a home run. Everybody loves a knockout. But he has so many good aspects of the game. His jab is really well. His foot movement does really well when somebody comes forward. And he knows how to throw combinations when he needs to.
Can I ask you a question, though? Is he in the same mold as a Carl Froch in the terms of, can he fight when somebody's on his chest, which I suspect, which is what Andre Ward's going to do to him?
It depends. Pascal tried to do that.
Pascal can't box. Pascal's just a wild slugger.
That's what it is, though. But the thing about it is he tried to come forward, and Kovalev was able to control him. First, like in the first fight, there was control of him, and then he just flat out dismantled the poor dude in the second fight.
Yeah, well, if Ward can get on the inside, there's plenty there for him, I think.
That's what makes it a 50-50 fight, because Sergey Kovalev has not faced anybody with the skill set of an Andre Ward.
Now, let's bring Gus into this. Your thoughts on this?
I think Gus ran out.
Okay, I didn't see. I'm sorry. I wasn't paying attention. So, yeah. So, I guess that sums it up here. I kind of agree with Ingram and Michael here. I think, you know, Kovalev, he will win and win in a relatively easy manner. I just think he's that superior. He's fighting with real momentum and real incentive as well with that Ward fight coming up in November. He's not going to lose this. Fighting in his home country, too, this is going to be all bad for Chilumba. Really a showcase about it, if we're going to be honest about it. And I think we're going to close the show on that note. Ladies first, Gail Falk with all the community's digital news. For folks who want to talk boxing or anything else, let the folks know where they can find you.
My column runs on Communities Digital News, which is com, C-O-M-M, digi, D-I-G-I news, comdiginews.com. I can be found on Twitter at PR Pro San Diego. Just look for that redheaded woman who ran off with Francisco Vargas' WBC belt. which is what I'm holding in the photo.
new to the show. First time on the show. Ingram from Baylor at Boxing. For folks who want to talk the sweet science or anything else, let the folks to work and talk where they can hit you up.
Thanks of all. Thanks for having me on the channel or the station today. It was fantastic. Really enjoyed it. I really enjoyed talking to the other boxing pundits tonight on the show as well. You can check me out and check out what we do on Baylorick TV, interviews, features, the lot. Baylorick TV Boxing Channel, that's on YouTube. You can check us out. Baylorick TV on Google, and of course we've got Baylorick Worldwide, which covers stuff such as stuff about Beyonce, Destiny's Child, and all sorts of other things outside of boxing news stories, the lot. So check us out, Baylorick. Just type in Baylorick, B-A-Y-L-O-R-I-C, B-A-Y-L-O-R-I-C. Check it out on your Google, and you'll find us all there. Thank you so much.
Indeed, indeed. Mike Money, Michael Boyce, a.k.a. Mike Money. For folks who want to talk boxing or anything else, let the folks know they can hit you up.
Yeah, you can hit me up on the Twitter, MikeMoney214, MikeMoney214. I'm just a boxer fan. I love the podcast. I love talking boxing with you, astute, with you, wonderful, astute people. Talk of boxing, I love it. I love the sport. I just don't want it to die. I want the best to fight the best. You can find me MikeMoney214 on Twitter. Once again, it's a great podcast, and I love talking boxing with you wonderful folks.
Indeed, indeed. Daniel Carpio from the Inscriber. For folks who want to talk boxing, the NBA, especially the Miami Heat, let the folks know where they can find you.
All right, folks. You can find me at Ruckus99 on Twitter. Like I said, do write for the Inscriber magazine. Just had a piece out. Just detailing, unfortunately, the bitter divorce that we just happened between Dwayne Wynn and Pat Riley. And I just want to say right now, if you are in Dallas, please stay safe. There's a really bad situation going on right now in Dallas involving snipers.
Yeah. Let me give an update on that. There was a protest in Dallas as a result of senseless killing in Baton Rouge. Rouge and Minnesota the night before involving cops, as far as I'm concerned, wrongly killing two black men, protest in Dallas. And it seems as if some snipers just went crazy tonight. 10 people shot, 10 officers shot, 3 dead, 3 dead, 3 critical. We're doing this as a taping of all this is happening. So again, I'm with you, and I can figure out speak for everybody here. Our condolences and our heartfelt thoughts to those who have been injured tonight in Dallas, Texas. So proceed, Danny.
Yeah, that's mainly where it is. Just be safe out there. The suspects have not been caught yet. But, and like I said, everybody be safe, and like I said, just be careful, please.
Indeed. So I think I want to thank Jacob from Jabu Boxing who joined us on the show earlier. Thank Gus from Corruption and Boxing who joined us on the show who just had to dip out. For folks who wanted to talk boxing with me and whatnot, you know what it is. Brother JR on Twitter at Brother JR76. Again, for folks who want to talk, who want to know more about pound for pound boxing, sorry I'm distracted. I'm watching this newest thing develop while we're recording the show. Folks who want to talk boxing again, talk pound for pound boxing report, just go to the blog page, p4pboxingreport.wordpress.com. Check the right of the blog page. You'll find links to find us all over social media, all over the internet, all over interwebs. Facebook, G+, YouTube, the Twitter handle. Would have also linked to find the Tumblr page. Would have find us on Pinterest, the RSS feed, and also would have find us on Stitcher Radio, Flip Bar Magazine, SoundCloud, iTunes. On the next episode, we will do a recap of Kovalev and Chalemba, and we will do a preview of Deontay Wilder, who is fighting Chris Areola on the 16th in Birmingham, Alabama. On the undercard of that bout, Sammy Vasquez will be fighting a real good welterweight prospect. In Cardiff, the return of Rigo, Guillermo Rigondeaux, he's going to be defending his belt on the undercard. Your favorite fighter, Daniel, Terry Flanagan, he's going to fight on that on the undercard of that bout. So, for Gail Falkenthal, the Community's Digital News, for Baylorick Boxing, Ingram from Baylorick Boxing, for Mike Money, for Daniel Carpio, Jacob Rivera, Gus from Corruption and Boxing. Again, our condolences to those injured. It looks like that sniper attack in Dallas. And also condolences to Alton Sterling and the brother, my mind is just going all over the place, the brother who was killed in Minnesota. His name escapes me right now. The brother who was killed in Minnesota earlier. So, we do this show as a lot of news is developing right now. This has been episode 132 of the Pound for Pound Box Report. We were all over the place. We apologize for that. So for Gail, for Michael, for Ingram, for Daniel, Gus, Jacob, I'm your host, Michael. We will see you guys next week.
Good night.
Good night.